Hello and welcome to Roland Schwarz 35, a series of technology presentations. My name is Rainer Stuhlfort, and in today's presentation I would like to share some insights of a new Release 17 topic in 5G background, non-terrestrial networks. So to give you a brief technology outlook. Against my usual habits, I would like to start first with a disclaimer. As this topic, non-terrestrial network, is not yet specified, I would like to share the current status of research, my understanding of the use cases and some technology challenges. So please be aware that all the information I'm going to share with you in this presentation is subject to be changed. I hope that's understood. So when in looking into the non-terrestrial network situation, I have to say this is for me a déjà vu. When we remember already in the mid of the 90s, when the ITU, International Telecom Union, launched this initiative for IMT 2000, so International Mobile Telecommunication in the year 2000 and beyond. There already was a design goal of an ubiquitous communication for worldwide coverage, so based on satellites. For some reason, this never really took off commercially. Nowadays, we can see that the situation has changed. So we see all the progress and the sophisticated evolution in the air or space industry with launching of satellites. We have drones, we have airborne helicopters, balloons, and so on and so on. And on the other side, we see the evolution in the wireless communication technologies, especially 5G. So our triangle use cases in 5G, all the service requirements. So we can definitively contemplate that the time is ripe for satellite-based non-terrestrial networks. So let's see into more detail. First, looking into the scenarios and applications. For example, there is from the European, the ETSI, a document targeting at mobile and fixed communication network, especially in the range from 6 to 7 gigahertz, so in the currently in ISM band. From 3GPP, we see two major trends. One trend is somehow called new radio over non-terrestrial network. So the main aspect is to shape the 5G new radio interface that we remember from release 15 and adopt it for the usage of non-terrestrial networks, so airborne based base stations, especially like satellites, GEO, LEO, and also high altitude platform systems. The focus is either on fixed terrestrial cells or even the cells can move over the ground. Later on, more words on this. And we assume that a device, a UE, will support satellite and also non-terrestrial network communication service. From a business case point of view, simplified saying, this new radio over NTN focuses on the human factor, so especially ubiquitous high data rate internet access, especially to provide coverage for remote areas. Then a big tremendous demand is for this public safety here. If you look at the cataclysm situations, catastrophic situations from like earthquake, hurricanes, etc., or even like cruise ships or the navy ships or airplanes, where we have a kind of local hotspot, a certain amount of users, and we would like to provide internet access to them. On the other side, the network will be extended with this background like Internet of Things over non-terrestrial network. So this is more from the business case, the IoT focus, so machines. Yeah? So our terminals will be machines. And just like an example, sorry, this is not 3GP and NTN based, but as an example, I would like to share with you a Roland Schwarz project where we worked on is this Icarus, yeah, for example, which is a nice application. So Internet of Animals, it's called, like here a situation with the ISS, the International Space Stations, where we try to track animals, for example, here birds, by using the 400 megahertz band. So just as an example that we need to provide machine type communications based on an airborne traffic. So I found a statistic, hope this is right, and this says today when we look into wireless communication, we cover about more than 60% of the human population, but still less 40% of the landmass. So, what could be a probable outlook into the requirements of beyond 5G, so of the next generations, etc., then we may see that one possible outlook could be the requirements for much better and much wider coverage. So when you talk about coverage, especially another aspect is the frequency range. And I just quote here a document, DRP 1932-34, which proposes various frequency ranges, mainly lying in the S band, so 2 to 4 GHz frequency band, or in the Ka band, which is in the 17 to 40 GHz frequency band. Like here, just showing you certain tables as examples where the engineers are proposing, let's say for the different ITU regions here, the Pacific, the European, African, and also North and South America, for these various regions and various use cases, whether the satellites are GEO, non-GEO, or whether they are airborne based, like drone or balloon based with HAPS. So we may use different frequencies for non-terrestrial networks. So let's start with a one slide covers everything, so like NTN in one slide. So from certain scenarios, we want to provide coverage for pedestrians, low speed, for ships, for airplanes, etc. So processing, propagating with various speeds. We have different types of base stations. They can be spaceborne, so satellites with different orbit, GEO, MEO, medium Earth or low Earth orbit satellites. We may assume an airplane or a helicopter or drones or balloons, so various types of base stations. And we also have different deployment scenarios for rural and remote areas, for disaster relief, but also for local hotspots or even temporary hotspots, like maybe a rock and roll concert happening in a rural and remote area, and we would like to provide wide coverage and high data rates. So just a quick look into the timeline. As I mentioned, NTN, non-terrestrial network, is a feature of Release 17. So we see the timeline in 3GPP. Release 17 is expected to be launched, fully specified, somehow in the third quarter, Q3, Q4 of 2021. So again, reminder to my disclaimer, all the technology proposals are subject to be changed. One slide just to present that we have different types of form factors of base stations. So as I said, satellites, we know this balloon project, and also we know the project of using helicopters, airplanes, drones. So here, this technical term, sorry, this for me, crazy acronym, apologies, but this is this high platform altitude systems, so coverage provision. From 3GP perspective, we have various kind of deployment scenarios and why we may need satellites or airborne base stations. On the top side of this slide, this is more like an interconnection between ground stations, to have wide range coverage. So a terrestrial base station is connected via a satellite network to the 5G core network, as one example. Also, we may see that we have a terrestrial GNOT B that uses the radio access satellite link, or even we may assume that we have a satellite-based or airborne-based GNOT B for satellite access. Other areas, for example, in 3GPP, we cover the possibility of having an inter-satellite link, so satellites like a peer-to-peer communication. We have a hop and forward principle from the gateway, from the core network to the end user terminal. And the end user terminal can, for example, be a kind of fixed, a static device, like here this VSAT, very small aperture terminals, or it can even be a handheld or IoT device that is allowed to move around and to be, let's say, undergoing a certain velocity. And also frequency-wise, we have frequencies beyond or above 6 GHz, so mainly the Ka band, and we have frequencies targeting in sub-6 GHz, for example, the S band. And also what is possible in the NTN scenario is a kind of cooperation between a satellite link, so radio link via satellite, and we can use as a link to a terrestrial base stations. So if you look into 5G, we know in 5G we have this multi-link connectivity, like a dual connectivity. A famous example is this NSA mode, non-standalone access with LTE and 5G. And maybe in future you may think at a dual link, that one radio link is provided by a satellite base station, for example, and another radio link is provided by terrestrial base stations. So just as example that we cover a vast and wide range of certain scenarios and applications. Just a quick look into some technical details, and I don't want to read all the numbers here, but just as an example, what are possible UE types, like a VSAT. One challenging part is a higher transmit power, so up to 33 dBm. For some of you, remember that is the transmit power of your GSM mobile phone from those times. And even the size, we may talk about up to 60 centimeters diameter size. So in terms of over-the-air testing, this would be an important topic. Or even we may talk about a handheld, so human person hand carry, like a 23 dBm power class, the same, by the way, as LTE. And also 5G, new radio, and we have, of course, the size like a smartphone, so typical handheld size. From this scenario and deployment, another example how widely covered these different deployment scenarios are from 3GPP. Here I quote the source of the TR technical report 38811. This is, for those of you who would like to get more information on NTN, this is worth to read. Yeah. So, for example, we have here different deployments using geostationary orbit satellites, non-geostationary orbit satellites, or even some HAPS, so like airborne drones, helicopters, etc. Another interesting aspect is, for example, the bandwidth. Up to 800 megahertz bandwidth. So this is the nice feature of a satellite. So the frequency range we target at, here the Ka band for example, this offers the possibility to use a much wider channel bandwidth, so for, let's say, higher data throughput. And we also target at FDD, but also TDD is possible. From the scenarios, from a user specific, you can see here different types of use cases, from a pedestrian up to this Internet of Thing, but also public safety or even airplanes connectivity. So interesting is, for example, the column from the speed, starting from stationary devices like IoT, going up to 1,000 kilometers per hour, so like a high velocity, like a typical airplane. And even the data rate varies from the range of a few kilobit per second up to hundreds of megabit per second. That should be the data rate provided to an end user device. So you see, quite challenging numbers we have to cover with our NTN technology. So some listing general overview of certain technology challenges, and later I will dig into more details on those. So no doubt, when we have a satellite link, for example, then we have a large distance between transmitter and receiver, and this causes a very high path loss. So free space path loss, and we have to counter that, especially with the mechanisms of beamforming, so antenna arrays. Then we should not forget that we may have a velocity. So either the terminals, the UE, may move, and also a satellite, if it's not geostationary orbit, but then also a satellite may move, and this causes some Doppler shift. Another impact is, of course, due to the long distance between transmitter and receiver, is the very large round trip time. So here just a number we calculated for a GEO satellite is more than 540 milliseconds. If you remember that new radio 5G requires a maximum round-trip time of 2 milliseconds on the interface. So round-trip time is definitely a big challenge, as again, we cannot fight against physics. We have to use the speed of light. And also due to this round-trip time delay, we may also have some challenging impact, especially on channel status information. So for example, like a feedback for uplink beamforming, this is the challenging part with the feedback, that it will arrive delayed at the transmitter due to this large round trip time. A technical impact is, for example, the receiver transmitter hardware architecture with a carrier frequency offset, especially when we go for higher frequencies. So the same like the millimeter wave in 5G. And also we should not forget that due to the satellite, the orbit case, we may deal with a larger cell size, and especially a challenge is the round trip time spread versus the coverage size. Other challenges due to the large distance is, for example, the random access. So a UE that starts a random access signal to a satellite, we have beside interference aspects, but we also have the big challenge of this missed detection. So the satellite receiver should properly understand the random access. And here's some research topic, for example, is a proposal of a new PREG sequence using some waveforms. Maybe some of you remember this filter bank multi-carrier. That was a waveform discussed in the early 5G days, and now it's coming again for because it has a better peak to average power ratio and also lower out of band emissions. So some discussions on that. Another big impact is, if you remember and look into the HARQ, H-A-R-Q, so data transmission and getting a feedback and acknowledgement. From 5G today, we know that we have up to 16 HARQ processes. If I now take from the previous slide that 544 millisecond round trip time, then it would theoretically end up into 545 HARQ processes running concurrently in my chipset. So which is of course a big challenge for the MAC layer. So some countermeasures, for example, are either we reduce and sacrifice data throughput, or we try to compensate a better reception performance by automatic retransmissions. For example, a feature that we know from narrowband IoT, just as one example. And another channel is, just quote here a figure from these waterfall diagrams, the different signal-to-noise ratio versus the modulation encoding scheme, the throughput. So in 5G, remember, we have our adaptive coding, adaptive modulation scheme, which is then based on a CQI channel feedback, so channel estimation. But this may not avail for a long round trip time radio channel in satellite communication. So then we may have to slightly adjust the modulation encoding scheme selection process. Coming into more details, so especially latency. As I said, we cannot fight against physics. I have no idea how to speed up speed of light. Yeah, maybe you have, but I don't. So for example, 3.3 microseconds for 1 kilometer. For 1 millisecond round trip time, we have already 100 kilometer distance, and we cannot accelerate this. So the good news is that when we take a closer look here, I found a statistic from the Deutsche Zentrum für Satellitenkommunikation, so the German aerospace. Yeah? And for example, like here, the 200 millisecond, that is somehow an accepted delay for a voice. Yeah, we know from the history from GSM and 3G. So when we now take a closer look into this maximum delay that a human person would accept, we can see that some satellite communication is still below this latency. So that means, of course, we cannot cope with all latency requirements. So ultra reliable and low latency in 5G is maybe not beneficial for NTN networks, but for many other applications like web browsing, like maybe a voice call, like some kind of file download, etc. These services, they still run properly on an NTN with long latency. Yeah? Some challenges, for example, from the geometry aperture, we assume we have a satellite, and now the satellite with multiple beams covers our planet Earth here. The line is this, the crown, terrestrial crown, and now we see, depending on the elevation angle, this will cause various cell sizes. And also later on, the movements, the speed of the satellite may cause a floating Doppler shift. round-trip time, because of these large cell sizes, we see that we have a difference in the round-trip time at the cell edge compared to the shortest round-trip time, which would be here in the zenith angle, zero of the nadir of the devices. An example again from the academics. When we look into the round trip time, we see depending on the orbit, so here the altitude, the different colors is the orbit height, and then we can see it's still possible to design an NTN, a non-terrestrial satellite based network, that is still providing a certain latency. Yeah? Another impact in the NTN network is a Doppler shift. So as I said, like here I took the figure of a vehicle, and even we have a satellite that is not geostationary. So we have speeds on transmitter and receiver, and you remember the formula of the Doppler shift. So we will have a kind of Doppler shift. And this needs to be countered and tackled. For example, we can use the orbit of a satellite and to do some carrier frequency adjustment at the receiver, or another strategy would be some kind of Doppler precompensation at the transmitter. As an example, the challenges here, if I take the UE as an example here in the center, and in the first position the satellite is coming from the right. So it's flying here from right to the left. So first position, the satellite is approaching the UE. That means we will have a Doppler shift, positive. Then we can see the satellite above the UE, so in zenith direction. Then we can see now the Doppler shift is somehow minimized. And in the third position, the satellite is leaving the UE. And then we can see here we have a negative Doppler shift. So this is the challenge, is the Doppler shift distribution. So we have a kind of a jump from positive to negative frequency Doppler shift. And a possible outlook technology would be a kind of pre-compensation. So like a pre-distortion on a power amplifier, is now also the same idea to do a pre-distortion. So to use a frequency shift in advance to compensate this kind of Doppler effect that's going to happen. So some research is working on that. Another big impact is, for example, capacity. When we talk about satellite networks, maybe I have multiple satellites, they all have multiple beams. So especially, what is the coverage of one beam? How many users will be here? And especially in the uplink direction, how many satellites are, let's say, receivers of the uplink signal of one particular UE? But a terrestrial network is mainly a shape based on a two-dimensional coverage. So we have the map, the ground, and then we install and deploy our base station, typically provide a certain coverage on the ground, here on the terrestrial ground. Then we have neighbor cells just in a two dimension. So left neighbor, right neighbor, yeah, and so on and so on. In satellite constellation, this looks much different. So we may also look at the aspects of uplink interferences, as we have many, many receivers. Like shown here in this academic picture, again, we can see the coverage, the radius, and the number of satellites versus the beam width, or let's say the opening angle of the antenna beam of a satellite. So let's say an important deployment figure will be, of course, how many satellites do you need to provide certain coverage for the area you would like to go for. Another impact is mobility aspects with satellites. So there are different kind of use cases, and here a possible situation could be a satellite that is non-geostationary, is flying, but this satellite has no beam lock, so it uses multiple beams. So that means from the UE perspective, depending on the elevation of the satellite, the UE would always see a different beam. If we now consider a beam as a separate cell, or either maybe a separate frequency channel, then we can assume that this causes a lot of signaling overhead due to cell selection, cell reselections, and even handover. So more or less simplified, we can go from a mobile device to a mobile base station. Another example could be a base station, a satellite airborne base station with beamlock functionality, like shown here in the animation with beamlock, the trajectory of the satellite with a locked beam, but definitively depending always, because the satellite is flying around the orbital elliptic sphere. So the satellite with beam will have a kind of birth and death situation. So the UE will see the certain beam, but then somehow it will disappear. Yeah? And this will also cause some challenges in terms of coverage aspects. One example from capacity planning. So as a network operator, for example, today in a wireless network, I will do capacity planning. So how many base stations depending on the capacity. Maybe some of you remember the telephone networks where we use this unit, one Erlang. Yeah, remember, one Erlang corresponds to one person doing 60 minutes telephone call. And this was in the early days of 2G, for example. This was a shape factor for the design, how many base stations, how many frequencies we use in our GSM network to provide a certain capacity. What is now the challenge with the satellite? So I see here the dotted line. This is, let's say, the trajectory of the satellite, and the circle, that is the assumed coverage area. But now, as we can see, assumption is we have a floating coverage, so a moving satellite. That means we have a floating cell size, a moving cell size. That means, like somehow shown here, in some moments of time, the coverage area is over a certain populated area, so you need more capacity. And maybe some time later, the satellite is over a remote area, so you need less coverage. So the challenge is, what will be your design criterion? So how much frequency bandwidth you provide, how much resources you provide with the backhaul connection, so means how much capacity do you provide, yeah? And how often, on how many percentile of the day you can use this capacity. So this is a very important design parameter as well. So capacity aspects, so from a satellite, single satellite perspective, there will be questions like how many beams, one beam or multiple beams, how many beams simultaneously, what is the angle, the beam width of one single beam, can I reuse the frequency, how many channels, and then of course the energy impact, like what is the antenna gain, the maximum power, the EIRP power, and let's say also the various frequency support and frequency channels. And it's getting even worse. Another example, when I don't take a satellite, but now I'm using a drone, and even it sounds funny, like steering a drone and control it to fly, yeah? But maybe a photographer knows that a drone with a camera, the most important impact is to place, to position the drone, for that you get the best perspective and the best image. And the same happens for our base station drone. Yeah? So positioning the drone is a complex problem. For example, is my target like a hotspot of UEs? Maybe a football stadium, remote location, hotspot, lots of people are meeting there. Or is maybe a moving target like a cruise ship, a car, a train, etc., etc. So that means we can either control the drone in the 3D position with commands like up, down, left, right, forward, backward. And then, like there's here giving you an example, some artificial intelligence entering this kind of discussion with, for example, this Q learning algorithm. So having a certain quality of service metric, then take an action to steer the drone in another position to monitor quality of service, and either I keep that or I try to undo my decisions. Another challenge impact is, for example, paging. If you remember from the 5G, the cellular network, we have a tracking area, routing, registration area, routing area, and this is more like from a two-dimensional dimension. From a satellite perspective, a satellite may provide multiple beams, so a UE is camping on a single beam, for example. So that means we change our world somehow from a mobile UE to a kind of mobile base station. And give you some ideas from the research. For example, I could use the geolocation data from the UE, and this goes into the ephemeris, so the orbit information on satellite, and then I can, in the core network, I can calculate a kind of candidates of satellites and drones and airplanes, etc., that will carry this kind of paging information. Yeah, so that is also a challenge on the network. Other challenges, for example, are radio propagation models. We have these shadow effects. Then from a satellite, what is, for example, shown in this figure, we have a kind of plane wave propagation, because the distance from satellite to the user device is considered to be a large distance, so we can assume we have parallel, like a homogeneous network transmission, homogeneous radio interface. Yeah, but from the path loss model, for example, we may have to combine a satellite, so atmospheric models combined with a terrestrial model, shown in my next slide, for example, here from 3GPP. The simple calculation of a path loss is getting more challenging, because we assume the device is on a sphere, the Earth, but the satellite has an elliptic orbit, this orbital plane. So that means we have either atmospheric losses here in the distance around the satellite, and we also have a free space path loss in the free space, and also some climate, some ionospheric, tropospheric scintillation impacts. Then of course we have the foliage, the buildings, etc., etc. So this is definitely another challenge from channel modeling and path loss calculation. So my last slide, as we see, there are some challenges, but this is good, and this is a challenge also for test and measurement, to see how we can tackle this NTN research. Yeah, for example, there is a wider bandwidth needed. We talk about a large size and also high UE power. So for example, Rodin-Schwarz, we have this plane wave converter approach, which is large devices, full undercorrect chambers needed. We may have to work on signal deterioration like fading, Doppler effects, a delay spread, delay time additional, so a pre-distortion of the frequencies to compensate the Doppler effect. This is, for example, task we can handle with our signal generator family and our signal analyzer family. A simple question is, of course, coverage. For example, we can base our network scanner either backpack, so in the mountains, we can put it on an airplane, we can put it in a ship, etc. Other aspects is, for example, the coexistence between the channels. For example, the S-band considered for NTN is an adjacent band to existing LTE and 3G band. So careful with coexistence in device. Yeah, the channel models I explained already. And then last but not least, of course, the NTN will also cause a kind of business discussion with business models. For example, who is building the use equipment, who is manufacturing the kind of base stations, the airborne and satellite-based base stations, who is doing the revenue sharing, what is the business model, how do we charge the data consumption, etc., etc. So you see, there are some nice challenges and opportunities ahead. So that's for me for today. I hope I could bring some insights into this non-terrestrial network. Stay tuned, as we expect there are many changes and new features coming in future. Thank you for your